God, humble us so that we will be capable of hearing your word. We thank you for the gift of yourself in scripture. We rejoice in its complexity. We pray that you give us the simplicity to be confounded by it. Amen. Confounded seems to be about right. For years, my approach to choosing what to preach has been to be guided by the church year, and to then further preach what I love and preach what annoys me to no end. That's why you've got sermons on some of my favorite books in the Bible, and on Luke and Matthew, and you've got sermons on the Psalms, which I just struggle mightily with. Now, Paul, I have never preached that great length on Paul, and so I need to learn to love Paul. I don't follow Paul's writing style easily. The dude's sentences, he just needed a period. He needed an English teacher to say, "Dude, just stop." But he just keep up. There are, when they're translating Paul, there are entire paragraphs that are one sentence, right? And there's no such thing as, when he's writing, there's no such thing as a paragraph. There's no such thing as a period. It hasn't been invented yet. And so it's just letters. And it's,
you're out of breath.
Exactly. Oh, give me a comma. We get breath mark. I don't follow Paul's writing style easily, and the tight logic of how he reasons is not something that comes naturally to me. Anyone here ever try to run a MacBook, open up a MacBook? I run PCs, and I open up a MacBook, and I look at it, and I acknowledge that it's a computer, but I can't make it dance. It's the same thing. I open up the Paul, I acknowledge it's the Bible, yeah, but I just can't do it. So I, as an act of commitment, I'm going to preach every book of the Bible before I stop, and then which isn't anytime soon. But I decide I need to chew on Paul. And there's no better way to force yourself to learn something than to set yourself a deadline, say I'm going to teach it, and then you all show up. So I knew I had to finish sort of getting my mind around all of Paul by right now. And I was up until about 12:30 last night, still working on this. I still have much to learn, and so I brought you sort of an overview, some very, I think, interesting stuff. Please feel free to interrupt and ask questions. I promise you I won't know the answers to all of them, but there'll be good ways to, you will hear the answers, just not stay in the sermon at some point. I think it is interesting to note that Paul does seem to be need to be rehabbed. Anyone here have an even abiding love of Paul? Anyone here really just know that's your favorite books of the Bible? Yeah, I'm not surprised. Right? Methodists, mainline, Lutheran, Catholic, sort of Anglican, we do not tend to get excited about Paul. We tend to like ourselves in Matthew, right? Some Luke, give me a narrative, give me a Jesus said this, and then we can talk about what Jesus said. We don't tend to really spend much time with Paul. Why is that? Most preaching in mainline denominations of narrative, you want to hear a story, right? You want to hear someone get up, pastor tell a little bit of himself, a little bit about yourself, or talk a story. Let's talk about how God intersects the story, and let's talk about story. Preaching on Paul is what's called propositional. You make a proposition, and then you sort of explore what's that proposition, what's that argument mean for us. It's a different style of preaching. You hear it far more often in Baptist and Christian, like Disciples of Christ, Christian Church, that sort of Reformed traditions. There's a reason that we don't tend to spend much time on Paul. It's been kind of in our nature. And additionally, we don't spend a lot of time with Paul because he does seem to have a hang up about women. And if you notice, the traditions that don't preach much about Paul, ordained women, Methodists, Lutherans, right? We ordain women, and so we don't talk a lot about Paul, and Paul doesn't kind of have a hang up about women. And the traditions that preach a lot about Paul, Baptists, they don't ordain women, right? There's some logic there. There's some reasoning behind why that happens. And then the writing of Paul in general is, when he writes a letter, what he is doing is writing to someone he loves, kind of give him an elbow in the ribs. And it's not pleasant. Because he's writing because there's a problem, and he needs to address a problem. And it's just, it can be a buzzkill. I mean, who wants to open up the Bible and read about how screwed up their early church is? Man, can't they get their act? I mean, it's just kind of a buzzkill. So that's why Paul is such a challenge to read, why he needs some rehabbing. So, general notes, that's spheres the structure today. That's your introduction. Now we're going to talk about Paul, the person. Paul is a Jewish rabbi trained by the best school. I mean, in the day that they didn't have schools, they had sort of teachers. He was trained by Gamaliel. So he has the equivalent of some like Harvard or Stanford. He has the finest education. He was raised in Tarsus, which is a trading city. So he's from the big city, family with money. He has Roman citizenship. Now, everyone here is a citizen, right? We sort of assume if you're in America, you're a citizen. That's not a given in Rome. In Rome, citizenship is you have to inherit it and you have to have earned it. And so the fact that he has Roman citizenship is a big deal. He has rights that most of the people in Israel don't have. He has the right to court. He has the right to be able to testify. Like, if you're not a Roman citizen and a Roman citizen says you're guilty, well, you're guilty. So he's good family. He writes himself, it's in Philippians 3, if anyone has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. I was circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrew, as the law a Pharisee, as the zeal a persecutor of the church, as the righteousness under the law blameless. So he's got the right family, he did the right things, he can trace his lineage, right? That's, you know what it means to be a good stock. I mean, that kind of phrase. That's so-and-so's kid. You trust him, right? He has everything going for him. And the role he plays in the Jewish establishment of the day is kind of like vice presidential candidates play today. What's the vice president? What does the vice president do in politics? But he's the one who can be mean, right? He's the bulldog. He's the one who can go out and take a swing at the other candidate, and he doesn't look like a bad guy for doing it. You don't want your presidential candidate to look bad. You don't want him to get down in the dirt. You send out your vice president to be able to take a swing. And so in modern days, it'd be your David Axelrod or your Karl Rove type figures. He's the guy who can go out and just get down and nasty and dirty. And that's what Paul was. He was the bulldog of the Jewish establishment. Right, this is the reason why the Jewish people have some sort of form of local control in the region of Israel, Palestine. And they are scared to lose it. And part of what the reason Rome lets them have local control is because they're old. In the days of Rome, this is another fundamental disconnect between then and now. Now, what's better, a new phone or an old phone? New phone, right? What's better? A new way? I mean, new is like a new car, new house. New is better. In the first century, old was better. Because the best days were behind you. The most imaginative, inventive days were the Greeks. And the Greeks got conquered by the Romans at the end of the century, right? And so old was better. They're trying to be as good as they used to be. And so old was more respected and new was suspect. And so for these Jews who are saying, Jesus, 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 to be showing up is a threat to the Jewish people, because if they go from being an old religion that Rome respects to a newfangled one, they're going to lose power. They're going to lose their political autonomy. So this is a great risk for them. Like, they've already sort of run the risk, because Jews are monotheists, one God. And all of the rest of the Roman Empire are polytheists. They're pantheon, right? And you have all these gods, and you can worship whatever god you want, as long as you don't say, worship whatever god you want, don't talk smack about someone else's god. That's kind of how it works. They let the Jews get away with having only one god and saying no other gods exist, because they're so old. Right? So when Jesus shows up and starts arguing for a new way of being Jewish, Paul has to go out because the Jewish people are terrified. They are terrified for their future. Does that make sense? So Paul is there when Stephen becomes the first martyr. It's in Acts 7. Stephen is stoned. And then Paul, after that, I'll read it to you in a second. He has this conversion experience. He goes and he gets letters of authorizing him to go from one, from Jerusalem to another. I forget where he Paul rode to Damascus. He was on his way to Damascus, where he could go and find and rout out other Jewish Christians. And on the way, he has this moment. This is Acts 9. Meanwhile, Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked him for letters to the synagogues at Damascus, so that if the town any of these belonged to the way is an early way of referring to the church, men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. So he's not joking around. He's going to tie them up, bring them home, and they're putting them on trial. Now, as he was going along and approaching Damascus, suddenly a light from heaven flashed around him. He fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, "Saul, why do you persecute me?" He asked, "Who are you, Lord?" The reply came, "I am Jesus, whom you are persecuting. But get up and enter the city, and you will be told what you are to do." The men who were traveling with him stood speechless because they heard the voice, but saw no one. Saul got up, he was blinded. 3 days later, he was without sight, and he was neither eating nor drinking. And a fellow named Ananias was sent by God to Saul. And Ananias answered, "Lord, I have heard from many about this man, how much evil he has done to your saints in Jerusalem. But the Lord said to him, 'Go, for he is an instrument whom I have chosen to bring my name before Gentiles and kings and the people of Israel. I myself will show him how much he must suffer for the sake of my name.'" So Ananias goes to him, prays, he is able to see again. All who heard him were amazed, Paul, or Saul, "Is not this the man who made havoc in Jerusalem among those who invoked his name? And has he not come here for the purpose of bringing them down before the chief priests?" Saul became increasingly more powerful and confounded the Jews who lived in Damascus by proving that Jesus was the Messiah. After some time had passed, the Jews plotted to kill him. He hasn't been a Christian for more than 2 months and already plotting to kill him. But their plot became known to Saul. They were watching the gates day and night so that they might kill him. But his disciples took him by night, let him down through an opening in the wall, lowering him in a basket. And then he goes back to Samaria and then starts his travels after that. Now, his name, dude has two names. Why is he Saul and Paul? Why does he have two names? Notice in this, what we just read, he's called Saul the entire time, right? It's not that Jesus doesn't change his name. Like, Jesus goes to Simon and says, "Your name shall be Peter." This is a statement of, I don't know what Simon means, but Peter is rock. And so Jesus changes his name to make a point. Jesus doesn't change Saul's name. And the best, there are multiple sort of versions of why his name might be changed. The best I can find is this, the one that makes the most sense to me. In Acts 13, up through Acts 13, he's called Saul. In Acts 13, he gives this speech where he talks about the history of Israel. And he gets into Saul's Kish. Y'all remember the story of the first Saul, King Saul? King Saul, who was the first one chosen to be king over Israel. Paul got great in battle. And then David was a young man at this time. And Saul gives David a really hard time. At one point, gets away and grabs my kid with a spear at him. But David keeps on coming back, stubborn guy. And Saul eventually, because he simply will not bend, he will not repent, he will not recognize that David will be the next king, Saul is removed. Right? And Saul was removed, and Saul is the one who gives David the flag. And so, as Saul is telling this story about how the first Saul had been chosen, but then was then removed, from that point forward, Saul, who we're talking about today, became known as Paul. Right? I don't think that he got a new name. I think he literally, they started referring to him by a new name to make a point. Right? Saul was the one who, the first Saul was chosen and then rejected because he went to the line. This Saul will to the line and it changes him. And dude actually has four names. As a Roman citizen, you're required to have three names. A given name, a family name, an ancestral name, and then you usually have a fourth name, sort of a nickname or a common name. And so he was probably, Paul was probably the nickname, and then Saul and his family name and his ancestral name. So it was probably, the reason he goes from Saul to Paul, best I can tell, was to make you think of Saul. It has sort of been implicit. Does that make sense?
I think of Saul as being non-Christian, Paul being Christian.
But the problem with that is that he is Christian as of Acts 9, but he's still referred to as Saul until Acts 13.
And I guess I just think that he's already being Saul.
And that's the challenge. That's the easiest explanation. But if that was what was happening, you would expect either Jesus to call him Paul, and Jesus calls him Saul, Saul, why do you persecute him? Or at least you'd think he'd change his name right then and there when he gets to Damascus, and he doesn't. And so he doesn't change, the name isn't changed in the literature until he talks about Saul. And so this is a theory. It may or may not be accurate, we'll never know. But this kind of tries to make sense of why does it change then. The first of many times I'll say that today. Saul, who once gave flax to King David, then became Saul, who gave flax to King David's son. And then this Saul, Saul, the heir of his ways. And so, works out better for that Saul than the first Saul commits suicide. Kind of a bummer for him. So, that's any questions about Paul the person, Paul the man, before we get into his trials? Christians, he's going to stone them. These four Christians, he's going to build the churches. So, yeah, I know a few things like that. It's interesting. Paul's trials. You have this idea that Paul sort of, Jesus takes a 2x4 to Paul, and then he's off and traveling. It's like he's knocked off the horse, goes to Damascus, gets his sight back in 3 days, and he's off and running. Not exactly. In Galatians, the book of Acts and the letters of Paul both have biographical information about Paul. They can be like times. We're not going to try to get into the weeds of whether we should follow an Acts timeline or the letters, or timeline according to the letters, because I don't think it's helpful. I think we're just going to, they mostly line up, and that's good enough for me. But Galatians tells us, you have heard no doubt in my earlier life in Judaism, I was highly persecuting the Church of God and was trying to destroy it. I advanced in Judaism beyond many among my people of the same age, for I am more zealous. But when God, who had set me apart before I was born, called me to his grace, was pleased to reveal his son to me so that I might proclaim him among the Gentiles, I did not confer with any human being, nor did I go to Jerusalem to those who are the apostles, but I went away at once into Arabia, and afterwards I returned to Damascus. Then after 3 years, I did go up to Jerusalem to visit Cephas, Peter, to stay with him 15 days. And then he goes out traveling. So the dude has his moment, blind for 3 days, and then he goes to Arabia. Arabia is such a broad, where is Arabia? It's like that whole peninsula, the Arabian Peninsula. He takes a long hike with himself in the desert, and we're not exactly certain where that is. Some people argue he went to like Mount Sinai, but that would have been expensive. It really, really expensive. Maybe he did. But he then starts making these travels. And it's interesting to note, the reason that the church starts spreading beyond Jerusalem is people scatter after the stoning of Stephen. And so if you ever wonder, why? So the church is chilling in Jerusalem. They're doing fine. Stephen is stoned, and some run to other cities out of fear, and then they start churches there. And so it's one of those, dog wants to move the stone. No, but did the stone against Stephen end up doing something important?
Yeah.
It spread the church. It got it going, and so they spread them to Antioch and other places. Now, the reason that Paul can make these travels is that he is a Roman citizen, and so he's safe. Go to the Roman roads, he has rights to the Roman soldier. And the fact that he is also Jewish means that people can, he has an in on both sides. He can talk to Jews, he can talk to Gentiles, he has the credibility of being highly trained. We're not going to get into the weeds of his exact travels. I think it's more important to notice just the distance. Take a look at that. Anyone ever been over the Mediterranean? You hike all the way around the Mediterranean. You could walk from New York to California and get there quicker than you would get walking from Jerusalem to Corinth. That just it wasn't. I think we lose a sense of scope. That dude. 3,200 miles from Jerusalem to Corinth. It would take 67 hours by car for a week of driving 10 hours a day, 842 hours of walking, or just over 2 months. And that's all four journeys. It takes multiple journeys. It, on the flip side of that map is a potential timeline. Every timeline you get a Paul must always have an asterisk that says maybe. But if you just flip it over, you can just take a gander at that, the way that that's when he lands in a church, he's there for 6 months, a year and a half. When he travels for a year, 2, 3, 4 years at a time. So if you ever, you wonder where was Paul's home? And the answer is hell. And to note that he spent so much time at individual places, he did not swoop in, go to the synagogue, say, "Yippee, Jesus!" And then that was good. Right? He wasn't like, "Hey, we got Star Church, I'll see you later, send you a letter in a while." Tent maker, right? That was probably his dad's trade. He was good at. How long did it take to make a tent?
Long time.
Yeah, that's a lot of fabric. It's a lot of material. And it's not like some sort of lightweight Boy Scout where you go out for a weekend camping. If you're building a tent in this day and age, you might be putting your small children in that tent. You probably want a little some amenities, like more than four stakes. I mean, you could probably put some work into it. And so you got to trust someone. I mean, I guess the modern analogy is if you're buying a car, I mean, the biggest problem with the safety recalls is that it challenges, your faith in the safety of the car, right? Are you going to buy a VW anytime soon? Maybe. Maybe not, right? And so to spend a long enough time in a community such that you could trust the tent maker, that they don't. And so he is there setting up shop and spends time to get to the point where he is trusted in him. Another interesting thing is you look at all those places he stopped, and you look at all the towns between. How many towns did he stop at, try to get going and fail in? We'll never know. He didn't send any letters. Zero failures. How often did Paul just Paul's travels are challenging. He was imprisoned for a time, twice at least. He was shipwrecked. He was sent to Rome for trial. He became involved in a serious conflict in his last travel with Asian Jews. It's hard to know what this sort of a running theme of Paul is that he ends up in conflict with different sects of Jews on a regular basis. There was a fight for the soul of the Jewish religion going on at this time. Like, so there were you think of, there were Jews and there were Christians, and they argued and that was that. No. There were different people claiming to be the Messiah. There was one by the name of Bar Kokhba, who was the son of the star, or son of the stars. And he was going to lead a two-letter rebellion that came in the 70 AD, led to the destruction of the temple of the Romans. Had enough of these rebellious Jews. That's it. Done with them, right? Knock it all down. There was that. There were the Jews who just wanted to get along. There were the Jews who wanted to sort of get back to the grassroots. Let's get back to Leviticus. Let's get back to getting more serious about what God wants and stop having problems. For Paul to run into problems with Jews, it's like saying Republicans all get along with each other. They're all Republicans.
Ooh, that was kind of a little bit.
Paul's a Jew, and he's arguing with the Jews. And there's some Jews who complain to the Roman officials saying he's committed a crime. And instead of taking the risk with the local Jews who are against him and the local officials, he said, well, I'm a Roman citizen. I can demand a trial at Rome. And so he gets sent off to Rome. And then he goes, oof, we don't know what happens. It is believed that Paul was killed, executed in Rome under Nero. Emperor Nero, who was truly a wing nut. Y'all know the story about Nero and the burning of Rome, playing the fiddle by Rome. Yeah, that's, yep, crazy man. Some people argue that Paul was released and then went on to preach in Spain, but I think they're wrong. I've never seen anything like this before. Let's see.
One thing we didn't talk about was when he took his tent making. I think one reason he did that, because he boasted that he did not ask him for any money or anything, you know.
Very true.
So I don't know if he did all the places or not, but he would tell him, I've not been a burden to you, I'm not asking for anything. And I think he tried to pay his own way.
Yep. And there was one church he allowed to support him, Philippians. Church of Philippi, but other than that, he only asked the church. There was a famine that hit Jerusalem during his travels, and so he would go back to Jerusalem for money on a regular basis. And he leaned on the churches pretty hard. Hey, pass the plate again. I'm coming through.
Yeah, he took it up for
years. Yes, he did. That, man, if the modern pastor leaned on the church the way he leaned on for money, woo, he'd be leading after. There is, where does he end up? He ends up in Rome, where he is buried. I've been to St. Peter's. It was interesting to be in where did he end up? I think I just in 2009, Pope Benedict XVI announced excavation results concerning the tomb of Paul and the sepulchre of St. Paul outside the wall. The sarcophagus was not opened, but examined by means of a probe, which revealed pieces of incense, purple, linen, and linen from Paul bone fragments. The bone was reincarnated in the 1st or 2nd century, according to the Vatican and Vatican's art. Consistent with the tradition that the tomb was Paul's, the sarcophagus was inscribed in Latin saying, Paul, Apostle, Martyr. So, Paul is probably buried in Rome, and Peter is probably buried in Rome, too. I've been to Peter's tomb, I haven't been to Paul's tomb. I said Mark's tomb, actually. This has nothing to do with Paul, but if you go to Venice, there is St. Mark's Cathedral. And you go up, and there is they used to put screens up between the congregation and the altar. And they would, those screens would be like solid gold. Thing, gold, set with pure, impressive stone, jewelry. It's the type of thing that would buy a small town today. And you could pay €3, like $6 a time, to go up and see this screen. So I paid €3, whatever, I'm saying. And I'm walking up and I see
cycle loom corpus. Hook S here is the corpus, the corpse, the body of the disciple Mark. I paid 3 euros to go see 100 gold, but there's Mark? They smuggled his body out of the land controlled by the Muslims in Israel in a pork barrel because they knew that if his body was under pork, the Muslims wouldn't touch it. That is seriously what happened. There are like frescoes of Mark's body being shoved into a barrel in this like, it has nothing to do with Paul, but it's very,
very interesting.
Yeah. So that's the travels. Any questions about his travels?
Did he walk all this way?
Yeah. That was sort of traveling tent maker would probably kind of, what's the lady who shows up to sell jeans in this, and we're talking about it in the community center. She got, there's a lady who shows up and sells jeans in the community center. And I don't know if she like has a home base that she comes out and travels, but I'm thinking of her like, yeah, new jeans. She'll show up, she'll set up shop, you want some Western wear, you want some jeans, you want, I mean, I would do a lot of business with her.
From over by the mall.
Take all my money. sat down and you say, you know, I'm going to sit here and I'll work with you for a time. It's a different economy. You can go somewhere, you don't have money that you travel with because, well, money is hard to carry. It's heavy, but it's still. There probably were. It really would depend upon the area. I mean, because people tend to settle where there's water. Travel along the
coast. People would feed you then if you went to their home. It's a lot longer if people are trying to see how they feed.
There was a far fewer people that traveled, but a far greater cultural impetus that you will, the way that Who the Three Strangers show up to Abraham and he slaughters a sheep or something for him. Like, I'll get out.
Starve to death while I.
You take the
pill. Kill the sheep and let it rain.
You could cut, I mean, you could slaughter. You could have food drink by an hour.
Take a lot.
Kind of. I guess take off the first cut, leave the rest to hang. The point being, that's quite, I mean, if you come over, I'll throw out some chicken for you. But to cut up a sheep if someone shows up, that's a significant commitment to hospitality. And so that's the culture of the day. Sarah makes up some bread. So I mean, bread is, it's got it takes a while. So that's yeah. Any other questions about Paul's jaunts, long as they are? So Paul writes letters. The assumption that Paul has about when he writes letters is that they have a past. He's already been there, he's already taught them. And so if you read the letters of Paul, he doesn't say much about Jesus. Like, what did Jesus teach? Doesn't say much. What did Jesus say? What did Jesus do? Paul doesn't tell us much. Why? Because he already told them, right? These letters are not introduction letters that are starting from scratch, and they're letters of responding to specific situations and inquiries. So they're topical letters. And what's even more challenging about reading them well is they're only one half of the telephone conversation. You hit it when you hear someone on the phone, you're hearing half the conversation, you don't know who the other person is, what's up, you just hear half of it, and you get off the phone and you ask what's going on, and it might be completely different. This is what's happening. We are overhearing half the telephone. We don't know what exactly was happening in Corinth, but such that their whole way of practicing communion was getting off base. We can guess at it from the way Paul responds, but we're not certain. We don't know exactly how long in Galatia they had these Jews who showed up who were teaching them and needed to submit themselves to the law and become Jews and become Christians. We don't know how long they were there. We don't know whether, I mean, we still know. So we always read these letters with a bit of hesitancy, knowing that they're topical. Now there is there's a bit of a structure to the letters. When you open a letter, what's the difference between it being addressed to Mrs. Couch versus Benita versus Westmans? Right? That tells you something, right? And if you open it up, if it's handwritten, that matters. If it's typed, it matters. If it's typed with one of those printed signatures that wants to make it look like it was signed, but wasn't actually signed. I mean, all these cues you look at, they tell you something. In the same way, there is a structure to the letters here. Flip to the beginning of Romans. Yeah, Bible. Romans. You'll be able to follow along as I verses talk And how does Paul begin?
Read the first couple verses for me.
Paul, a servant of Christ Jesus, called to be an apostle and set apart for the gospel of God. The gospel he promised beforehand through his prophets and the Holy Scriptures regarding his son, who, as to his human nature, was a descendant of David, and who, through the Spirit of holiness, was declared the power to be the Son of God by his resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord, through him, and for his name's sake, we receive grace and the apostleship to call people from among all the Gentiles to the obedience that comes from faith.
That's the introduction, right? That's like when I would put, "Hey, Carolyn." That's his version of "Hey, Carolyn," right? And then he has the recipients to all who are the beloved of God in Rome, all the saints. And then he has this little bit of a greeting: "Grace to you and peace from our God and Father, Lord Jesus Christ." He almost always begins with a prayer of thanksgiving for them. That's kind of how he does it. First, I thank my God, Jesus Christ, for you all. You see, a great way to start a letter. Let me just tell you how much I am thanking God for you. Right? And so that's how he always writes his letters. There's one letter in which he does not give thanks. It's the letter to the Galatians. And as you'll hear shortly, in Galatians, Paul is angry. Paul is hacked off. Paul is bitter. He is frustrated. And so he does not begin by saying, "Thank God for everything that's going on there," because he can't. And so that's the type of thing where noticing that he writes a letter helps us understand how it would have been read. Because every other letter starts with a thanksgiving and Galatians doesn't, it tells you about where his mindset is.
Very chapter, he starts with, "You foolish Galatians."
Oh, yeah. Oh, God.
Who bewitched you?
In my New Testament class, they had, he would give, as far as the text, say, "Here are three verses, tell me what book it's in." And the Baptists at Duke loved that section. What an evening for them. And I had to, how do you learn to tell which is which? And so if it says immediately, it's the Gospel of Mark. If Jesus sounds confusing, it's the Gospel of John. And if it sounds like someone's really hacked off, it's Paul in Galatians. That's when Paul is really hacked off. And so after giving the prayer of thanksgiving, Paul usually gives his feet. So they're sort of, "Here I am, writing to you. Aren't we wonderful? Thank God for you, and here's what I'm going to talk about." And then near the end, there's almost always a moral exhortation, the equivalent of when you left for high school or college or the military, whatever, your mom would tell you to put on clean underwear. That sort of those last comments. Make sure to write home and call your mama and send your dad a birthday card and all those things. He just kind of piles on it. And so it's good to know that, because those moral exhortations at the end are important. They're the word of God for us, the people of God. Does it shape how you read it to know that this is the equivalent of your mom saying put on an underwear? Right? Is it quite the same import, impact, weight as in the middle of it when Paul is saying, "In Christ there's neither male nor female slave nor free female"? It helps us understand how much weight to put on something to understand the letter. And so then the farewells, the close to the end, we have this moral exhortation, and then we have the farewell, which tends to be short. The farewells in this time period tend to be not quite as short as ours, which is our farewells are sincerely, comma, or peace, or till next time, whatever. They would usually do one sentence, and Paul's ending of Paul's letters, he looks like gush. "Now tell so-and-so that I can't wait to see them, and tell so-and-so that they're just doing great work, and that is wonderful." And the fact that he's going on and on, sort of gushing at them, is sort of, it's kind of that southern nice. He's just laying it on. "You know, I'm just loving, so glad to hear from you, so glad I could hear what's going on." Which is then interesting, because in the letter to Galatia, which I noticed he was angry at the end, instead of giving like a farewell of, "You know, just tell so-and-so how wonderful it was to hear from them," instead of giving them one last Thanksgiving type of moment, he piles on again. He says, "Now let me chew your butt one more time and make sure you know." He is just getting angry in that way. So we have these letters. Now, we don't have every letter. We don't have every letter. There are letters that are lost. There are letters that we know that are lost, and there are letters that we don't know about that I'm sure he wrote that we just don't have. There is a letter to Corinth that he writes before 1 Corinthians. You could call it like half Corinthians or something. I don't know. There's a first letter to Corinth, and that, so Corinth writes Paul. Paul writes them back. Corinth writes Paul. Paul writes them back. That's 1 Corinthians. Alright? So then Paul visits Corinth. It doesn't go very well. It's the sad trip, right? And then Paul leaves and he writes them the severe letter, or the letter of tears. We don't have that. And then they write him back. And then he writes them again. And that's 2 Corinthians. Right? And so when I say that you're only hearing one half of the conversation, it's not only we're only hearing one half of the conversation, we're only hearing one half of one half of the conversation. Right? So it's a bit of a challenge. So Corinthians, we don't have all those letters. There's another letter to Ephesus. There's a letter to the Laodiceans. That's referenced in Colossians 4. Right, so we have these letters. Anyone know off the top of their head what order the letters are in the New Testament?
Well, how do you know when it's referenced?
You know when it's referenced.
Just because of the chronological order, or a question is asked and never answered?
We know when Paul tells us. 1 Corinthians 5:9 refers to my first letter. And so 1 Corinthians 5:9 says, in that previous letter I wrote you. And then in 2 Corinthians 2:4 and 2 Corinthians 7:8-9, Paul talks about the letter of tears. In that last letter I wrote you, that was kind of heavy hard on you. Okay. So we only, an earlier letter to the Ephesians is referenced in Ephesians 3. And so if we had both of those letters, we would have Ephesians 1 and Ephesians 2, but we don't need to have Ephesians. So we only know we lost a letter when Paul tells us that there was a letter.
In the 13th and 2nd Corinthians, it starts out, this will be my third visit to you. There's only two visits on the map.
Did I tell you everything should be taken with a big old asterisk or something, maybe?
Yeah.
We don't know. There are trips that he tried to get to that he didn't end up making. He did end up in prison.
He didn't say this will be my third visit. Yeah. So maybe he didn't get there for it.
Best laid plans of mice and men and all that. So there is definitely, there are lots of letters we don't have. There are letters we know that we don't have, and he tells us he references them. But other than that, we're not. It's amazing which letters we have, right? There are enough to, we have enough letters to put together kind of an arc. It kind of holds together coherently. We have enough letters to really kind of get a handle on Paul, which is a blessing. What are the order of the letters? Do you all know what the order of the letters are in the New Testament?
You mean the order that they actually have to
know
their order?
Well, why are they in the order they're in the New Testament? They're ordered by length. The most useless organization field pattern. We can imagine doing your filing system by, this is the longest file, we'll put this up front.
That's the way the prophets and the old ones. It's listed by the length of
it. Yeah, Isaiah, it's stupid. It doesn't help, it doesn't really. Far be it for me to disagree with the Bible, but since I'm going to, it doesn't make sense. It doesn't help us. So I think we're gonna go through the letters in the order in which we believe they were written. We're not 2 Corinthians and Galatians kind of gets dicey which one's written first, but in general we think it's 1 Thessalonians, 1 Corinthians, Galatians, 2 Corinthians, Philippians. Romans, and Philemon's in there somewhere. Philemon just doesn't have enough data. So we'll look at those seven letters, and then there's some others we'll get to. It's time for everyone to refill the coffee. You know, the thought was that he might have had sight problems because he, at the end of his letters, he would sometimes write, oh, look, this isn't my handwriting. In one of the letters, he did that in most letters. In one of the letters, he wrote, this isn't my handwriting. Oh, look how big my writing is. And so he might have had sight. He might have been losing his vision. We don't know. That's a short version of this. We don't know. Thank you. Fletcher for a second, and I can't hear Fletcher. So it's a dangerous moment to get here. And I look over, and the door's wide open, and he's out to the sidewalk, at the end of it, about to walk into the street. Oh, there's a just pulling up in her black car, watching. And I run across in 30-degree weather, and run out across the grass with a pair of sports shorts, grab him. It's okay, Pearl, I got him, I got him. You got to move that chair. Down there at that really good Amish store west of Brookfield on 36, and those hamburger sandwiches. They do like a sandwich. It's awesome. It is great. You pay like 50 cents for double meat, and it's just like a meal. We got in, they're clearing some of their cedar deck furniture, so I got to take care of it. Put it up against the rails, and I walked out. Fletcher's on the deck alone for a second. He got up on the chair, climbed the back of the chair, had his hands on the railing of the deck. Until now, we've been able to let him run on the deck, and he's outside, and he's happy because he can run around and close the gate. And nope, now he can't go out there by himself. The only room that I can put him down in and not worry about him hurting himself is the nursery. That's it. There's not another room in existence that we can put him down and not worry about him killing himself. I'm sure that sounds familiar. Y'all raise kids too. And that's just, he's doing well.
I wrecked my son twice.
So we're going to plow through the letters, and I do not have a huge amount of data on some of these letters. I'm going to give you sort of a snapshot of each of them, but I have a lot to learn about these letters as well. So 1 Thessalonians is the first letter written. The context there, as with most of the churches, is mostly Gentile. And this is one of the only letters where things are doing well. He's not writing because there's a big old crisis. He's not writing because the church is blowing apart at the seams, or any communion is going off track, or they're kicking people out. And there's nothing. 1 Thessalonians is the most pleasant of Paul's letters to read, because it's just kind of chill. Nothing personal in nature. I mean, he spends it's like a 5-chapter letter versus does first the first three letters is kind of drinking coffee with, hey, how you doing? Good to catch up with you. And then at the end, he talks about, it's been a bit, y'all, we were expecting Jesus. But then we come back, yeah, those who have died, don't fear. Do not grieve as those who are without hope. But know that they have fallen asleep in the Lord, and he's going to be fine. That's true. That's 1 Thessalonians 3. And then we get to 1 Corinthians. Corinthians, if you call someone Corinthian, isn't it like the adjectival? When someone said, oh, was the insult is, if you say someone has New York values, I mean, that kind of, you sort of impute the city on someone. You can do that with Corinthians. Except if you said someone was Corinthian, you were saying they were loose and moral and promiscuous. You were doing everything short of just saying you're a hooker, right? If you call someone Corinthian. And there's a reason behind it being like that. It had been destroyed in 146 B.C., then re-established in 44 B.C. using former slaves and former infantry, former military. And so it was a key trading location. So you had to have a place there to control the waterways, the trade passageways. And Rome had to build, they had to destroy it because it was rebellion, I believe, but they had to rebuild it because it was a great place to collect taxes. You can't charge taxes. But when you read starting from scratch, you have no sort of social norms, you don't have the good old folk who have been there, you don't have the century farms, you don't have people who have invested in the land, you just got whoever shows up. So they showed up and they brought their hookers and their beer with them. And that's really not an exaggeration, it's really just a rough time. Paul had taken 18 months to found the church, a year and a half there. The church had been there 5 years. And so this is a church plant, a church start, that seems to have worked. But the church has come to this crossroads, and it is about to blow apart, it seems. It's really just starting to fall, about to fall apart. The themes he's sort of hitting, community, he's telling them, you are going to learn to live together. And he's kind of, kids, you are going to learn to share, or you're not going to have anything. He's kind of put the smack on. You are going to learn to live together, so grow up. Stop your jealousy and stop your quarreling. This is where, in response to this situation, he starts developing this imagery of the body of Christ, of the church is the body of Christ, that we are all connected. And so this becomes a foundational metaphor for everything that imagery he uses in all of his next letters. And so he's developing with them, reminding them that this is a new way of life, that you can't just do whatever you want, that you have to live a new way. Part of that is a new way of communion. The way communion had gone off the rails was meal, right? You show up to worship and you hear some stories about Jesus, you talk about the Bible, which at this time is the Old Testament, because the New Testament is written. And so, and then you have a meal together, the communion, the Passover type meal. And so everyone would bring their food and you sit down and share a meal. Well, those who had food, those who brought the bread filet brought filet. Those who brought gruel brought gruel. And they weren't sharing. Those who had filet ate their filet at one side of the table, and those who could only bring vegetables ate the other side of the table, and that was that. And so, what would that do to the church? You know, I bought the pot roast. That's for me. Everyone else, you just go have your cream corn in the corner. Corinthians that misuse used at times to make this argument, don't, there's this idea that you can't do anything that offends someone else in the church.
Those are friends things, right?
If it bothers you to eat meat, then you shouldn't eat meat. That doesn't have quite enough of the weight on what eating meat meant. There is this sense of what Paul says, you know, if Christ is willing to die for these people, can't you skip your hamburger? Right, there's kind of that weight to it, but it's not just eating a hamburger, it's eating a hamburger in the context of pagan worship, that would draw them back to pagan worship. So that's the type of question Corinthians, the church at Corinth, is struggling with. Right. And then you throw in that his son is sleeping with the mother, which is not quite, they might be about the same age because women die a lot in childbirth, and so maybe it's a second wife, so maybe the father's died and he's sleeping with his stepmom, but still, ugh. So that's Corinth, right? They're kind of just struggling with sex and food and community, and anyone who ever says we should just try to be the first century church again, you point them at Corinth and you say, really? That's, you want to go back to arguing about that all the time? And so that's Corinth. And then after Corinth, before we get into Galatians, there is, I think it's on your chart, there's the Acts 15 Jerusalem Council. This is the most important decision the early church makes. At Acts 15, it's in Acts 15, there's this argument. Some believers who belong to the sect of the Pharisees stood up and said, is it necessary for them, Gentiles, be circumcised in order to keep the law of Moses? The apostles and elders met together to consider this matter. After there had been much debate, Peter stood up and said to them, my brothers, you know that in the early days God made a choice among you that I should be the one to whom the Gentiles and give the message to the believers. And God, who knows the human heart, testified to them by giving them the Holy Spirit as he did to us, and in cleansing their heart by faith, he has no distinction between them, Gentiles, and us, Jews. Now, therefore, why are you putting God to the test by placing on the neck of the disciples a yoke that neither our ancestors nor we have been able to bear? Well, on the contrary, we believe that we will be saved through the grace of the Lord Jesus as they were. The whole assembly kept silent, listening to Barnabas and Paul as they told their stories of their travels. And so they come to this decision. I reached a decision that we should not trouble those Gentiles who are turning to God, but should write them to abstain only from those things polluted by idols. Polluted by idols would be the meat, right? The meat that had been offered as sacrifice to idols. And from fornication, keep the pants on unless you're married. And from whatever has been strangled, and from blood, don't carry blood. And for in every city from generations past, Moses had had those who disclaimed him, for he had been read aloud every Sabbath. And that is the decision that happens at the Jerusalem Council, Acts 15. And then they go back to Antioch. And that Antioch had become where sort of the home base for the missionary impetus of the early Christians. There were five great, they're called five great patriarchs, dioceses, a patriarch and a diocese. Of the early church. Jerusalem was the first city of Christianity. Then Antioch, that's where Paul was based out of. That was the second great city of the Christian faith. Then Rome, as spread west. Then Constantinople, going back east after a few hundred years. And then Alexandria down in Egypt. And so those were the five great cities of early Christianity, beginning with Jerusalem. And then for a bonus point, since anyone, so Rome, in later centuries, Rome becomes like the center of the Christian faith. And then when Rome falls, the second Rome was Constantinople. It was called the second Rome. Anyone know what the third Rome was? Completely random. Moscow. Moscow claimed the title of third Rome because it was the head of the Eastern Orthodox Christianity. That's like 700 years down the road, though. So after the Acts 15 Council, which they agree that those who are not Jews do not have to become Jewish before they can become Christian, that sets us up for Galatians. That gives the context. there have been these, the Pharisees who have become followers of Jesus. I mean, you think about it, like, these Jews who have followed Jesus, these Jews who have decided to follow Jesus, they don't stop being Jewish, right? They have a certain way of living, and that certain way of living has been formed by a lifetime of being Jewish. And so it's not like they're going to stop wearing the little kebab around their head, whatever. They don't stop wearing their prayer cap. They don't stop being Jewish. They are Jews who follow Jesus. And so it makes perfect sense to them that as they go and they invite other people to follow Jesus, they say, well, what's that look like? Well, it looks like me. I follow Jesus. Look like me. Well, what do you look like? Well, I look Jewish. So you should not eat pork. And so there are folks who are sort of pushing this too far. And so Paul is not the only person out there traveling and sharing the news of Jesus, and after he has found the church of Galatia, some people follow him afterwards, and they're there, and they say, oh, you follow Jesus too, let's talk about it. And so Paul has left, and there are some people who have they've come to Galatia, they're Jews who follow Jesus, and say, look, we'll teach you some more about Jesus, this will be great. And so they start teaching about how they follow Jesus, and they're Jews who follow Jesus, and so they start teaching them to be Jewish. And it's an interesting thing. This really gets at the nature of what a heresy is, because what they're teaching is that the idea that you should pay attention to the Old Testament, of course. And I just spent two, three weeks on Leviticus, which is not exactly, it's been a challenge to make it tricky. It's not the New Testament, and we will land back to the New Testament shortly. So to say that you need to pay attention to the Old Testament is not a bad thing. The problem is when a heresy is when you take a good point and you push it too far, right? If you take a good point, you should pay attention to the Old Testament, you push it so far that it becomes a requirement for being able to follow Jesus, then it's a heresy, right? And so Paul hears about this, and he is angry, and so he writes to them in this letter to the church of Galatia. He's telling them that you are underestimating the power of the Holy Spirit to guide people. You have an insufficient sense of what the church is. The church, the people of God, that have been changed by what happened on the cross, has changed it so the Jews and Gentiles are in the same boat and in the same environment. Right? You don't have to be Jewish before you become a Christian. This is where he gets that amazing phrase in Galatians 3. There's neither male nor female, slave nor free, Jew nor free. Gender, ethnicity, class are secondary to being Christian. And so he gets at this, and it's a deep roller. Any questions about Galatians? Okay. Now we come to 2 Corinthians. Now this is probably two letters stitched together. If you read 2 Corinthians, you read the first, it's 13 chapters long, you read the first 9 chapters, it has one tone, and then you hit chapter 10 to 13, and it is completely different. It doesn't feel like it's the same letter. It really just feels very different once you hit it. Some people will argue that 2 Corinthians is two letters, and that the chunk 10 to 13 is actually the letter of tears that is between 1 Corinthians and 2 Corinthians. Maybe not. 2 Corinthians doesn't have like the coherence. Like Romans is like building this massive argument. In Galatians, there's a theme that runs through. In 1 Corinthians, you move step by step by step. 2 Corinthians is a little bit more random. But he's still working with a church that has problems. He gives them the passage of 2 Corinthians 5 that we are to be ambassadors of reconciliation. If you want the cleanest, simplest definition or description of what you follow Jesus, 2 Corinthians 5 is it. Not that it's, it doesn't get any clearer than that. But God got right with us, and we are to be ambassadors and get right with others. It's hard to say much more about 2 Corinthians without getting into the means of it, because it's this kind of scattershot. Philippians, Paul writes this from jail. We're not sure exactly when. Philippians gives us the Christ hymn, Philippians 2:5-11. Have this attitude in yourselves, which is also Christ Jesus, who, although he existed in the form of God, did not regard equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, and being made in the likeness of men. Being found in the appearance of a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, and the death of the cross. For this reason also, God highly exalted him, and bestowed on him the name which is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee will bow, of those who are in heaven and on earth and under earth, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, the glory of God the Father. Another really long sentence. And I just simply don't know much more about Philippians. It does have that in it. Philemon ends up being this very short letter that Paul writes that deals with a servant who escaped. The term, if you see the term servant or slave in the New Testament, it's the same word. And we go back and forth in our translation because when we say slave in modern America, we think of 18th century Southern slavery, racial-based slavery, and that's not what it was then. It wasn't necessarily permanent. It wasn't mass. People would have a few servants or a few slaves. It was not like plantation stuff. So when Philemon, Paul writes his letter to Philemon, Philemon does do an interesting thing. Paul suggests very clearly, saying, Philemon, you might want to let this slave, Onesimus, but he never just flat says it. Because I'm in charge of the church, I'm telling him, let this go. He never just, he says it. Because this is my logic, I think you should do this. And let the person do it. And I think that shows us something important about Christian leadership, that when it comes to Christian leadership, telling people what to do is almost never, you can't convince them. Then we get to Romans, which is the last of the letters, as far as we can tell. Romans, I will preach on Romans one day. It is 15 to 16 chapters of some of the hardest and most dense reading in the entire Bible. I'm intimidated by Romans and Isaiah. Those are the two books that intimidate me most. He is writing about how to trust God. How do you understand what God has done? How do you trust God? If God is working in certain ways with the Jewish people and something's changed now, what does that mean? He says again and again and again, first the Jews, then the Gentiles. That's the kind of refrain letter that works, first the Jews and now through the Gentiles. And so Paul is struggling to understand how God saves the people. And that actually gets back to this community theme. Paul is concerned for the salvation of the people. He wants individuals to make decisions, but he is very communal focused. The body of Christ, the church, the salvation of the Gentiles, the salvation of the Jews. He really focused on people making individual decisions for Jesus Christ. It's not the main thrust. He's looking for better people, better communities, and better churches. And so he's playing a big game. Now those are the seven letters that we are certain are from Paul. But the other letters, 1 Timothy, 2 Timothy, Ephesians, Titus, Colossians, and 2 Thessalonians, they're Pauline, and that some of them may have been written by Paul. We were reading Thessalonians last Sunday, right? And we were right over in Green City. And when you go from 1 Thessalonians to 2 Thessalonians, there's a real change in tone. I mean, you look at it and think, is this Paul? What just happened? And so that's the type of thing you look at these books, and we're just not certain, are they written by Paul, or are they written by a disciple of Paul? That's really the two options. They are Pauline, and that they are continuing to convey Pauline theology. But what we're thinking happened was that the disciples of Paul, who would have known the churches as well as Paul, conversation. And if you read the beginning of the letter, there's often Paul and Mark and John Mark, and sort of Paul's writing with people. And so they're sort of continuing the conversation, saying this is what Paul, like this is what Paul would say. And then there are other letters in the New Testament. John 1, 2, 3, the letters of John, Hebrews, which is a sermon by Jews to Jews about are you involved in Jewish. James is called a Catholic letter, a universal letter. But there's those seven that we know are Pauline, those are the seven that you have the outline to on those two pages. So, questions about the letters? There are some themes that come up throughout Paul. God is faithful. There is judgment. The cross is God's, the way that God shows it. God loves us so deeply. It's the solution to the human predicament. You notice that Paul doesn't spend a lot of time talking about Jesus. He talks about Christ crucified a lot. One thing we miss in English is the unity of the community. When Paul talks, when he says you, he almost always means y'all. Right? You might just go through whenever Paul says you, you might as well just cross it out and say y'all. Because we don't have a good second person plural. For some reason, people who translate the Bible don't want to sound Southern. And but that's an important note to have. There's a deep theme of imitation of Christ, that we are meant to be Christ-like. That we are thus to be people of reconciliation. That then you see that in places like 1 Corinthians 8, the struggle with me. If Jesus died to reconcile with people, you give up the chain. It's okay. Paul does a lot of work around, especially in Romans, around showing that the church carries forward what the Jewish people became. And that over that we do have something to look forward to, and that's there's a future that's going to come, and you already are getting to experience. Now, these letters are written over the course of 20 years, right? And so, you have to go back and look at something you wrote in high school. Yeah. It's you. I mean, you read it, and it's you. Like, I go back and read something. I was reading something I wrote for the Duke Plan Test 18 class back in 2003, when I was preparing. And that's Andy writing, same loquacious overuse of commas. I used too many commas, but I don't write like that anymore. Paul does the same thing. Paul's theology develops over time, and it's not that he disagrees with himself, but that he expands upon it. Like when it comes to talking about the end, right? In 1 Thessalonians. First letter that's written, there's this sense that the end is going to come any day, just keep on holding on, those who have fallen asleep in the Lord, they'll be fine and safe soon. 1 Corinthians, he started talking, it's at the end of 1 Corinthians, well, let's talk about the body that is resurrected, and the spiritual aspect of this as well. 2 Corinthians, later on in time, there are some changes that are happening while we're waiting. He talks about how we are a new creation. 2 Corinthians 5, right? We are being transformed right now. Part of him that will be with God immediately after that. All right? And so what we're seeing there is him sort of growing in his understanding and how he's explaining this topic. He's not disagreeing with himself. He is consistent, but non-systematic, usually. He talks about the long Galatians. He talks about it at greater length in Rome. There are a few exceptions. In 1 Corinthians 11, he says women should pray or prophesy with their head covered. In 1 Corinthians 14, three chapters later, he said women should not speak at all in church. And it made some sense. How can you say, if you speak, have your head covered, don't hack off social norms. Everyone start talking. If you do it, just keep your head covered, go for it. How can you go from that to saying women should talk in church? But then later on, he talks about the deaconess Phoebe. And his ministry is supported by women who help support me. He really
know, I there. And I think this is a bit, it gets at what you expect of. I don't expect him to be a systematic theologian. I don't expect him to try to, like, if you read Calvin's The Institute of Religion, A, you're reading like 3 pages and then fall asleep. It is some of the driest reading I've ever done in my life. Oh my God. And it's a systematic theologian, right? These massive tomes that, like, lay out, they begin with, like, a doctrine of God and a doctrine of the Trinity and a doctrine of the Church. And they tend to be thick and really small type. And they try to be, like, they coherent, if this, then that logic. They get so boring. And that's not what Paul's doing. He is writing in response to situations, and so if his advice varies by context, well, it varies by context, he's writing in different contexts. He's still Paul.
But he hasn't had much experience or relating to women, and yep. They've had to prove themselves.
Yep.
As he was referring to this.
And I think that, I mean, that gets at the question of how do we use Paul today, Paul's role today. That is the right question to ask. How does Paul grow? How does Paul reason? And how does he reason in the same fashion? When we read the letters, it is not an attempt to recreate the first century church. It is not, Paul's not giving us a blueprint to live. What he writes is authoritative, but it's not authoritative in the same way that what Jesus says is authoritative. When you think about when Jesus says something more authoritatively, when Jesus said, I'd rather have turkey instead of beef, is that an authoritative statement? I don't know. Because he had to have a favorite food, right? What was Jesus' favorite food? What we have, what Jesus says, is authoritative. It is authoritative for all people of all time. Right? So Jesus says, love your neighbor. And Jesus talks about the parable of the Good Samaritan. You can say that always applies. When you read Paul, what is Paul doing? Paul is writing to a context, trying to form how people imagine what they should do. If you, 1 Corinthians is a good example. They're sitting down to be with people, and it makes perfect sense to them that you should keep what you are. You're grounded. You would bring. And Paul is writing to them to try to help them imagine a better, a more Christ-like way of doing it. And there's a church I believe that's in Africa. Everyone brings a little bit of coat to church. And at the end of church, they're going to have their coats. And they all open their little sleeves of coat and they pour them into a punch bowl. And then they serve them out with cups. And I love it. Because it's so Pauline. It's so first Corinthians. This is what Paul's done in church before. You eat together, drink together. Don't bring what you want. That sort of shaping of imagination so that they would do something that they can't imagine doing because of Jesus. And so that's what Paul is trying to get us to do. And so Paul is someone who I evaluate as being human, inspired, and guided by God. He shows people how to take the next step as someone who is himself a few more steps down the road. But while Jesus paints the kingdom of God, Paul is struggling to show people how to take the next step. And it's a different thing. And so when we read Paul, it can never be just do what Paul says. Like in general, if Jesus says it, we should do it. You're going to be right. Did Jesus say it? Yep. Yes, sir. If Paul says it, thank you, Paul.
Well, Paul kind of explains the intricacies of how to do what Jesus says.
Mm-hmm. He's an interpreter for the first century. As the interpreter of Jesus for the churches of the first century, people had to change in 2,000 years. We still struggle with the exact same things. Yet our context has changed. And so that reading Paul is simply going to be hard. And I think part of, and this gets back to why the mainline churches don't read Paul a lot, the churches that read Paul a lot, in addition to being oppositional on their
you, Paul, being ready to grapple and imagine and work and struggle with it, which is just not a challenge. And you're going to do it right now because I can. I've talked a lot about Paul and how it's your thing because I can talk all the time. That's how I'm doing it. So we're going to talk about how to read Paul. And I think I can rustle up a few Bibles for everyone to make sure. And you're going to get out of here early because
I think you didn't know.
First, you gotta have an outline. You're doomed if you don't have an outline. Try to read Paul because every letter has a structure, and if you don't, the reason I like this outline is that it taps in like the first letter to the Corinthians as introduction 1:1-9, and then the response to oral communication, and what you've been told, and then it subsets 1, 4, 5, 6, and then the next 7 response to communication. It's 7, 8, 11. And it gets the conclusion. So this actually is formatted well. So first, if you're going to read Paul, you got to have an outline, or else it's just. Or you can create your own. The way that I study the Bible anymore is I end up making my own outline for the letters, and sometimes I've got to scratch them up, start over again because my outline isn't well enough organized. It's just, but the act of creating the outline gets it. So first you create outline, then you gotta do a little background research. Wikipedia has great articles on all of Pauline letters. Or cliffnotes.com. Or Halley's Bible Handbook. This is our floating around Halley's Bible Handbook. You ever seen one of these? Yeah, Halley's Bible Handbook. This is I found this over in the Great City Church. It was Bernice Mason's. These things have been floating around forever, and they just go through chapter by chapter, and just give you the short version of what's happening every chapter. And so you read a chapter and you think, that makes no sense to me. So these are actually really useful. And the problem with when you start getting into biblical resources, you can get overwhelmed really quick. I mean, if you look up books in the Bible, you just get buried in them. I mean, I own a lot of them. I get buried in them. This is the best short one I've found. Outline, and then review the context, and then you got to read the whole thing. If you think about, okay, so Paul writes a letter to the church at Corinth. Not everyone can read, and you only have one copy, and you don't have a photocopier, and how do most people engage the letter? They hear it, right? It was designed to be heard. And so, who here when you read, do you hear it in your head? Anyone? Olivia and I have this ongoing, it's amazing how often, like, when she reads, she can see the letter, like, actually, bullet. When she sings lyrics to songs, she can see the lyrics in her mind's eye, and she's like reading them as she's singing them, and I don't, and she is just utterly confused by me, and I don't see the words as I say them, but the point being, these books are designed to be read out loud, and so you might just need to read the whole thing out loud, and kind of get a sense of it, kind of get the cadences of it. Because there are times that if you're reading it, you're going to miss things. Like, Paul uses sarcasm. Like, in Corinthians, there's this thing about they think that they've lied, but they've already nailed it. They are already, like, full of spirit and good, right? And Paul sort of mocks them and starts saying, you are so full of the spirit. And if you're reading it, you kind of miss it. If you read it out loud, you're more likely to catch it. So create an outline, do some review, read the whole thing, maybe out loud, and then just start taking one chunk of the letter at a time, one piece of the outline, and see if you can make sense of it.
And so I'm going to invite you to take a look at, let's do Corinthians because it has the widest variety of topics. Take a look at the first letter to the church at Corinth and pick yourself a topic there that you're interested in what Paul has to say. If you want to sort of argue with Paul about incest, marriage, food, women and men at worship, problems at the Lord's Supper, problems of Christian worship, pick one of those arguments, and I'd like you to read it. Take a piece of paper and do something with it, and do what makes most useful to you. Either outline it, or paraphrase it, or argue with Paul about it, write a letter to Paul. If someone else, if you want to, I'll ask you to share which chunk you're going to take a swing at, if you want to work with someone else, and maybe you can argue with each other. But if you disagree with Paul, that's okay. It's not the end of the world. If you disagree with Jesus, that's a whole different discussion. Disagree with Paul, well, get in line.